Honourable Member for Oshawa.
Thank you very much, Madam Speaker, and I'd like to say how happy I am to be able to finally exercise my rights as a member of Parliament to speak to C-14. Over the last few weeks, I've actually been in line to speak, but because of the shutting down of debate and the antics that were being put forth by the Liberals, I am really pleased to be able to talk today for my constituents. I think it's really important when Canadians watch this debate, they do remember the debacle this week and remember that the vote that this was all about was a vote on Wednesday to shut down debate on C-14. And as my NDP colleague just said, Madam Speaker, we only have one more day, just a little over 2 hours, to debate 16 amendments. And I think what's really important for Canadians listening to this debate to get in touch with their MPs. They only have 1 week, and I want them to look at the amendments and get in touch with their MPs, especially their Liberal MPs, because, Madam Speaker, as you know, sadly, many of the backbench Liberal MPs as well will not be able to speak to this bill, and the reason is because their front bench does not want them to speak on it. And for me, and for every member in the House, and for all Canadians, this is a very personal and a very, very important bill, which will change the social structure of our country with strong views on many sides of the debate. If you look at the foundation and the founding principles of our country and the great democracies around the world, Madam Speaker, they're based on rights for life, for liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And today we are actually debating some of the opposites of that. The opposite of life being death, the opposite of liberty is enclosement and pursuit of happiness, the opposite is basically sadness. And what was really important with this bill, I've been able to speak but also to listen to many of my constituents with very diversified opinions. And I think it's essential for all of us here in the House to respect these many points of view. Some were at the extreme of one end, very much against this bill, others very much in favour of it. But what I can say is for most of the people that I was able to listen to, there's kind of somewhere in the middle. But one thing that they can most of the people in Oshawa that I've talked to agree with, the act of assisted suicide should be an exception and not the rule, Madam Speaker. In other words, assisted suicide should only be made available on the rarest of occasions and, of course, have the greatest of safeguards. And my concern, Madam Speaker, as you heard from my colleague here in the House, this is a flawed bill. And in the rush to pass this assisted suicide bill before the deadline of June 6, this Liberal government has created confusion and despair. And what have the Liberals chosen to do? They've chosen to break their promise to Canadians. And I wanted to bring up and emphasize my question to my colleague across the way. When the Liberals were campaigning, they promised Canadians that they'd put $3 billion into a palliative care system. And I don't know where my colleague was reading it, but when I read the budget, there is absolutely no new money for health in this budget. So in the first year, when the government is rushing to hit this date, there is no new money to support the other side of the equation. There's nothing, there's zero. And as far as health is concerned, Madam Speaker, this is a horrible message. It means that the Prime Minister, for him, healthcare is not a priority. And Canadians expect a choice between quality palliative care and this legislation. And instead, the Liberal government has chosen to support just one half of that choice. They have put all their time and their resources into assisted suicide and have not provided the promised $3 billion to palliative care, supportive care for Canada's most vulnerable. And that's why I called upon my colleague across the way there to call on the Liberal government to immediately keep the promise, and it's not too late to invest in palliative care. Because according to the Supreme Court and what we've heard, Canadians have the right to choose. To choose between assisted death, but hopefully the government can give them a choice to live comfortably near the end of their lives. And that's where I think this is really important and why I'm so glad I'm able to speak today. because the constituents I've talked to, they feel the Liberal government needs to be held to account. Making the choice between assisted death and good palliative care has to be made available by June the 6th. And why is this so important? Because, Madam Speaker, this is the first time in Canadian history that the Supreme Court or a government here in Canada is drafting a law that will make it legal for one person to take the life of another. And the Supreme Court has said it's not just a required service, but they've determined that it's a matter of individual rights. And what precedence does that set? And what do the experts in palliative care say? And I'd like to share with you, Madam Speaker, but also to Canadians watching this debate, my colleagues in the House, some of the thoughts of a very special constituent of mine in Oshawa. Her name is Dr. Jillian Gilchrist. Now, Madam Speaker, Dr. Gilchrist is a leading expert in the field of palliative care, and she has practiced medicine for over 50 years. She started the palliative care system in Oshawa in 1981, which is 35 years ago. And I really don't know anyone in the country with more experience, more respect, and more knowledge. Just recently, through an initiative with Lakeridge Health in Oshawa and Queen's University, a research chair has been named in her honour dedicated to palliative care. It's actually the first fully funded academic research chair in palliative care at a community hospital in Canada. And Dr. Gilchrist has said the following about proper palliative care. She has stated that it cannot be done without a team. And there's lots that palliative care can do. There needs to be more volunteers and training. Patients deserve support and the families need support as well. And one of the things she said to me very strongly is that euthanasia is wrong. Doctors should not do it. That is not what they were trained to do. And Dr. Gilchrist has treated more than 5,000 patients, and not one of those patients asked for euthanasia. She went on to say that palliative care cannot stretch across every corner in Canada, but with the assistance of the internet, patients can obtain assistance to treatment as well as support they need. So those individuals at the end of their lives can actually have a true choice. And we know, Madam Speaker, that experts have said that given the choice of good palliative care, 95% of patients choose life over assisted suicide. So, Madam Speaker, this affirms one of the most obvious weaknesses in the Liberal approach to this most personal and sensitive subject. How can the government rush forward so blindly towards an artificial deadline of June 6th without even providing the funds to improve palliative care options for Canadians? Have they even asked the Supreme Court for an extension? Madam Speaker, choice also belongs to doctors, whom the Supreme Court has said will have to perform this final irreversible act of assisted suicide. And doctors and institutions deserve the right of protection of conscience. We know, Madam Speaker, that doctors have taken the Hippocratic Oath that calls for them to do no harm, first do no harm. So the question is, why has this Liberal government failed to adapt the legislation to provide positive protection for those doctors and institutions who cannot participate in assisted suicide due to conscientious objections? The legislation, as it's being presented today, simply references conscience, but there's no guarantee of protection. There's a mishmash across the country. And Conservatives have proposed explicit provisions for conscience protection, Madam Speaker. However, this Liberal government chose watered-down protection. So for me, Madam Speaker, it's beyond understanding how a group of 9 unelected lawyers from the Supreme Court can tell physicians how they must practice medicine. We don't see medical doctors going out telling lawyers how to practice law, especially without guaranteeing their rights to abstain from a practice that all of them swore to would reject. And as Dr. Gilchrist told me, this is not why we became doctors. So, Madam Speaker, I saw that you've held up your finger. I only have a minute left, and I do want to repeat that I've been prepared for some time to speak on Bill C-14. Multiple times, and I've been able to listen to my constituents. And what I think is really important for Canadians to understand that this is not a debate about money. This is not a debate about technicalities. This is not a debate about regulations. Madam Speaker, this is an unprecedented debate about the subject of one individual taking the life of another. And it's a national debate. All Canadians deserve to have their voices heard. And I want to thank you, and I want to thank the House Leader for all they've done, because this probably is one of the most important issues that I've faced as a parliamentarian in the 12 years I've been here. Thank you, Madam Speaker.
Questions and comments, questions and commentaires, Honorable Député de Mont-Royal.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I want to thank the Honourable Member for his passionate defence of palliative care. I want to make sure that the Honourable Member is aware that at the Standing Committee on Justice and Human Rights, we added in two amendments into the bill related to palliative care. We added an amendment into the bill and the preamble of the bill, not only authorizing but mandating the Minister of Health to work with her provincial and territorial counterparts to ensure that we improve palliative care within Canada, as well as improve care for dementia patients, as well as establishing a proper end-of-life care for Aboriginal peoples that is culturally sensitive. We also, within the report that has to come back within 5 years in analyzing the law, agreed bipartisanly to ask that there also be a report on palliative care. So while I completely understand and I agree, the last thing anyone should want is that somebody should decide that they need medical assistance in dying because of lack of proper palliative care. Nobody should make a choice because I have too much pain, I want to have medical assistance in dying. Does the member not agree that the dangers of not having a bill in place, not having any safeguards in place as of June the 6th, should at least make him consider voting in favour of the bill, flawed as he may believe it to be?
The Honourable Member for Oshawa.
Thank you very much, Madam Speaker, and I really appreciate my colleague's question, because it does show that across ways, many people on different sides of the debate, there actually is a lot of agreement. And as a new member, I would like to point out, he says the Liberal Health Minister is mandated to work with the provinces and territories. Madam Speaker, working with is not the same as delivering an immediate $3 billion into palliative care. This bill, as it sits today, is extremely flawed, and it was brought up by my NDP colleague that why are the Liberals taking this approach? I asked during my speech, did they even ask for an extension from the Supreme Court? And I've heard many decisions by the Supreme Court, and I actually believe if you talk to them, they realize the work that we're doing. This is not something that needs to be rushed, and I think we have to do the best we can to get things right.
Questions and comments, questions and commentaires, l'honorable député de Longueuil-Saint-Hubert.
Merci, Madame la Présidente. Je suis heureux du ton des conversations ce matin sur un sujet aussi important. Je pense que la sobriété, l'élégance, la noblesse de notre fonction est à l'exercice ici. Je trouve déplorable de voir à quel point, en fait, je m'explique mal pourquoi le gouvernement cherche tant à aller vite dans le domaine en question. Quand c'est si délicat, on ne peut pas courir avec un sujet si délicat dans une espèce de grande porcelaine générale. On a ici des situations de des gens qui attendent une décision claire. Il y a des mentalités qui ont évolué. On a demandé au gouvernement, par exemple, de demander une extension à la Cour suprême. Pourquoi est-ce que ça ne pouvait pas être fait? Alors que c'est ça qu'il faut faire. Il faut se donner le temps de réfléchir. Je peux vous dire, en tout cas, qu'en tant que Québécois, je trouve ça bien triste de voir la maturité dans laquelle mes collègues au provincial, les citoyens du Québec se sont exprimés, et qu'en bout de ligne, ici, on chicane, on se tire la couverture sur un sujet qui devrait amener la plus grande noblesse. Alors, la question que je pose à mon collègue, c'est quand il dit ici, la question, c'est ici, c'est ça, la question n'est-elle pas au point de départ la souffrance des malades?
Honourable Member for Oshawa.
Thank you very much, Madam Speaker. And I want to thank my colleague from the NDP, who rightfully said he's from Quebec. And this issue was thought out. I believe they had 6 years of debate through different governments. And all members in the House had time to listen to their constituents, because this truly is, this is a matter of life and death. This is changing the social structure of our country. And he is correct. The Supreme Court put an artificial deadline. They came up with a date. The date can change. We're doing our work here in the House. Why does the government insist on rushing forward so that voices such as my constituents and my colleagues' constituents cannot be heard, and the backbench Liberal MPs, who I know Canadians deserve their member to be heard in this House?